video essay, we'll be going over what happens when you sequence courses of different types of osteoporosis drugs one after the other with regards to gains in bone mineral density at the spine and the hip. Although this is not always the case, fracture risk reduction is strongly correlated with BMD gains. I'm not really going to go into fracture risk reduction data, but I may touch on it during certain points. There's three types of osteoporosis drug transitions: the anti-resorptive to anti-resorptive, anti-resorptive to anabolics, and anabolics to anti-resorptives. And at the moment, there's no official data on anabolic to anabolic transitions. For anti-resorptives, I'll only be using these three, that is alendronate, zoledronate, and denosumab. And for anabolics, I'll be using teriparatide and romosozumab in this video essay. The anti-resorptives can be divided into the bisphosphonates and denosumab, which are distinctly different as the effects of bisphosphonates persist for months and even years after they are stopped, whereas stopping denosumab causes rebound hyperresorption, which is more profound the longer the course of denosumab is. Bisphosphonates are first line and effective for mild to moderate osteoporosis, but may not be potent enough for severe osteoporosis. So this BMD chart shows how the BMD gains for the bisphosphonates, that is alendronate and zoledronate, plateau out after around year 3. So this is BMD gains at the hip after around 3-5%. So if there's a patient with severe osteoporosis who requires more than 5% gain at the hip, then bisphosphonates are only going to be able to partially help them. So most osteoporosis patients will be started on bisphosphonates unless they clearly have severe osteoporosis. There will be a percentage of patients where the bisphosphonate treatment was unsuccessful. It would be reasonable to transition them to a different agent, for example, transition from alendronate to zoledronic acid. A study has been done which indicates that patients who are already PO compliant with alendronate may not benefit much from transitioning to zoledronic acid in terms of BMD gains. So how about alendronate to denosumab or zoledronic acid to denosumab? Most guidelines do recommend denosumab as a backup for bisphosphonate. In this study with Kendler et al., denosumab gives bigger BMD gains when transitioned from alendronate compared to that of patients who remained on alendronate. Bisphosphonates do blunt the effect of denosumab. So here is a chart from the Freedom study, which shows for the spine BMD gains more than 5% in treatment-naive patients and 3% in patients previously on alendronate. It is still a transition worth considering in patients not getting the desired treatment outcome on bisphosphonates. In general, the response to any therapy when given after alendronate is smaller than when given to a treatment-naive patient. This is because BMD increase of an osteoporosis drug is directly related to the rate of bone turnover when the treatment is started, and bisphosphonate inhibits rate of bone turnover. So we've partially covered anti-resorptive to anti-resorptive. That is, I've done alendronate to zoledronic acid and alendronate to denosumab. So how about from denosumab to bisphosphonates? It was found that for short courses of denosumab of 1-2 years, alendronate is able to counter the hyperresorption caused by denosumab discontinuation and even maintain the BMD gains achieved with denosumab. However, for longer courses of denosumab, the rebound effect is more profound, and alendronate will not be able to counteract the hyperresorption, and guidelines such as the European Calcified Tissue Society recommend that for longer courses of denosumab exceeding 2 years to transition to zoledronic acid, which is the more potent bisphosphonate. Although for longer courses of denosumab, zoledronate will only be able to partially counteract the hyperresorption. So let's go on to anti-resorptive to anabolic transitions. Let's start with alendronate to teriparatide. There have been a couple of studies to see what happens when you transition alendronate to teriparatide, and they've shown that you get a further increase in BMD at the spine, and same as denosumab, teriparatide effects are blunted by bisphosphonates. It can be noted that the BMD gains at the hip is significantly a lot less. However, real-world observational studies have shown that treatments with teriparatide still reduces fracture rate at the hip, although more data is required to confirm if this is the case. So what happens when you transition from denosumab to teriparatide? Is teriparatide able to counteract the hyperresorption of denosumab discontinuation? The data switch study followed 23 postmenopausal women with osteoporosis who were on 2 years of denosumab and then were switched to 2 further years of teriparatide. And at the spine, there was further increases in BMD. However, at the hip, there was a dip in BMD at 36 months that then seems to have recovered partially by 48 months. So note this data is only for 2 years of denosumab followed by 2 years of teriparatide, and the number of patients is quite small. But in any case, based on this, the general recommendation is to avoid denosumab to teriparatide transition, or at least use with caution for the time being. So the reason why it's thought this might be happening is that along with anabolic activity, teriparatide also has resorptive activity. So perhaps there is a net anti-resorptive effect which isn't completely counteracted by teriparatide's anabolic activity to begin with. Studies have shown that teriparatide tends to be more effective on longer courses, that is, BMD gains are better after 2 years versus 1 year. So this may explain the transient dip. There isn't any data currently to show what might happen if teriparatide were to be continued for longer. We can go to look at transitions to the other anabolic, romosozumab, which is the most potent at increasing BMD, but is limited to 1 year. So let's start with alendronate to romosozumab transition. In the structure study, the BMD gains achieved after switching from alendronate to romosozumab after 1 year was 10% at the spine and around 2-3% at the hip. In comparison, romosozumab gains after 1 year in treatment-naive patients is around 14% at the spine and 7% at the hip. So there is some blunting of romosozumab's effects, but overall there is still decent BMD gains at both locations if you transition from alendronate to romosozumab. So how about denosumab to romosozumab? Is romosozumab able to counteract the hyperresorption of stopping denosumab? As well as anabolic activity, romosozumab also has some anti-resorptive activity. So there is one study where 18 postmenopausal women with osteoporosis were put on denosumab for 1 year and then transitioned to romosozumab for 1 further year. And here it showed that romosozumab was able to further increase BMD at the spine by a further 5%. At the hip, there was no further BMD gains, but the BMD gains were maintained. So whilst in comparison with transitioning from alendronate, the BMD gains of romosozumab after denosumab is more blunted, but it still gives way more BMD gains than alendronate after a short course of denosumab at the spine, that is. So note in this study, the number of patients is quite small and the course of denosumab was only 1 year. More data is required to see how romosozumab would perform after longer courses of denosumab. So now let's move on to anabolic to anti-resorptive transitions. The anabolics available are generally restricted to shorter courses. For romosozumab, it's 1 year. Teriparatide did have a restriction of 2 years, which was lifted relatively recently in the US. There doesn't seem to be much data on what happens with BMD gains beyond 2 years, and most international guidelines will still stick to 2 years. So for this video, I'll just stick to teriparatide being limited to 2 years. Anabolics give good BMD gains, but when stopped, the BMD gains reverse and go back to baseline quite quickly. So it is important to transition to another agent in order to preserve some of the BMD gains. Otherwise, the anabolic therapy will have gone to waste. So let's start off with teriparatide to bisphosphonate. So in a study done by a Japanese team, Niimi et al., here they transitioned from 2 years of teriparatide to alendronate. And here they did use a lower dose of 35 milligrams a week of alendronate. And here the BMD gains were maintained. And then in the PATH study, they used parathyroid hormone instead of teriparatide, which I imagine would give very similar results. Here they used a shorter course of teriparatide of 1 year and then transitioned to alendronate at the standard dose of 10 milligrams a day. And the alendronate brought about a further 5% BMD gain at the spine. So at the hip, it looks like the teriparatide did not give any gains, and the 4% gain pretty much all occurred during the second alendronate year. In summary, it does suggest that alendronates can at least maintain the BMD gains of teriparatide and may even further increase them. So how about teriparatide to denosumab? In the data switch study, patients were on teriparatide for 2 years and then denosumab for two further years. After 2 years of teriparatide, the BMD gains at the spine were around 9%, and then after switch to denosumab, approximately further 7% was gained after 2 years. So altogether, you get an impressive 18 to 19%. For total hip, it was a further 4 to 5%. So you get a total gain of approximately 6%. And then in the Niimi study, again, the patients were on 2 years of teriparatide, but here they reported after a shorter time of 1 year of denosumab. So in any case, it does look clear that denosumab after teriparatide is able to further increase BMD at both the spine and the hip. And in the data switch study, there doesn't seem to be any blunting of the denosumab effects by teriparatide. So let's go on to the other anabolic, that is romosozumab. So let's do romosozumab to alendronate. As mentioned before, romosozumab does give the highest BMD gains at the spine and hip compared to the other osteoporosis agents, but its effects are only up to 1 year, after which it needs to be stopped. So the ARCH study shows after 1 year of romosozumab, the BMD at the spine was 14%, and then 2 years after the switch, it's still around 15%. So this does look like a good regimen. Another study done by McClung et al. And what would happen if a single dose of zoledronic acid were given afterwards. And they found that similarly, a single dose of zoledronic acid was able to maintain the BMD gains of the romosozumab for two further years. So this would be a more convenient regimen for osteoporosis patients than weekly alendronate for 2 years, for example. So the final transition for this video, what happens when you transition from romosozumab to denosumab? So the FRAME study shows 1 year of romosozumab BMD gains, 13% at the spine, went up roughly a further 4 to 5% gain after transitioning to denosumab. At the hip, it is roughly a further gain of 2 to 3%. It seems that romosozumab might blunt the effects of denosumab a little, as after 2 years in the FREEDOM study, the lumbar spine gains after 2 years were almost 8%, compared with in the FRAME extension study, it was around 5%. 2 years after romosozumab. And something similar can also be seen at the hip BMD measurements. What you would do after transitioning to denosumab, you could either continue denosumab or transition to a bisphosphonate. So the regimen which would give the highest gains in the shortest period of time would be 1 year of romosozumab followed by denosumab, which is able to give BMD gains of 18% at the spine after 2 years, compared with around 7 to 8% with bisphosphonate or denosumab alone in 2 years. A close second is 2 years of teriparatide followed by denosumab, which can reach 18% in 4 years, so one extra year, although not at the hip where it lags behind the romosozumab to alendronate transition. To recap, these were the osteoporosis drugs covered in this video. For the anti-resorptives, there's the bisphosphonates and denosumab, where bisphosphonates have long half-lives, and denosumab causes hyperresorption after discontinuation, which is more profound the longer the course of denosumab is. Of the anabolics, there is teriparatide and romosozumab, where romosozumab gives higher and faster BMD gains than teriparatide. Anabolics are restricted to shorter courses, but generally give higher BMD gains than anti-resorptives, apart from teriparatide at the hip. Bisphosphonates are first line, and bisphosphonates tend to blunt the effects of agents which follow afterwards, but you can still get further increases, whether it be denosumab, teriparatide, or romosozumab. With shorter courses of denosumab, alendronate is able to counteract the hyperresorption and maintain the BMD gains, but for longer courses, the more potent zoledronate is required, although may also only be able to partially counteract hyperresorption for longer courses of denosumab. Also, for short courses of denosumab, teriparatide and romosozumab are even able to further increase BMD gains at the spine, but when transitioning from denosumab to teriparatide at the hip, there may be a transient loss in BMD after 1 year, which seems to recover at around 2 years after the switch. And the BMD gains obtained from anabolic therapy can be maintained when transitioned to a bisphosphonate, and even further increased in the case of denosumab. And that is it for this video. Please check out the other PXP videos on osteoporosis if you haven't already. And just a reminder that this video is not meant to be used as medical advice. Always consult your own doctor for tailored medical healthcare advice. Thank you so much for watching.